family is fighting for justice 37 years after their neighborhood was bombed by police. Now, this happened in Philadelphia in 1985, and it was known as the Move bombing. Now, officers wanted to evict a Black liberation group from the neighborhood who had been classified as so-called terrorists by the police commissioner and the city's Black mayor. Here's what survivor Ramona Africa told Vice News in a documentary.
There was gunshots, thousands of rounds of bullets from the police.
Police moved in with tear gas and water cannon.
They wanted to kill our children.
I had recommended to use an explosive entry device.
The house shook. Smoke was coming in. So we knew they dropped the bomb on us.
Police allowed the blaze to burn an hour and a half before calling in firefighters.
I don't care what they said, there was no justification for what they did.
61 homes were destroyed, 11 people died, and 5 of them were children, all of them Black. Now a family has filed a lawsuit against the city of Philadelphia and the University of Pennsylvania over how they handled the remains of 2 young girls who were killed in the bombing. Their bones had been used in an anthropology case study, unbeknownst to the family, who has since recovered their remains. And the sisters have been laid to rest. With me now, attorney, political commentator, Bakari Sellers, and Lionell Dotson, who is the brother of 2 of the victims. Gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. First off, again, condolences to you and your family for just such a heartbreaking loss. 2 of your sisters were killed in that 1985 bombing. Now, how did you find out that the university had your sister's remains?
Well, I found out just last year, back in April, scouring the internet, and I stumbled upon it. I said, hey, they're my relatives that they're talking about.
What is your feeling about how long this has taken for you to even find this information out and for you to have an opportunity to pursue some justice?
Well, first and foremost, this is like gut-wrenching. It's like a low blow for them to, you know, to pick people in such a manner, for them to put them on display. And, you know, it's systemic racism. I mean, I just can't find words to describe the pain that I'm in right now for this.
Bakari, I do want to ask you around the damages issue here. Obviously, sure. There's going to be a need for some compensatory damages for the anguish and the trauma and the emotional toil. What about punitive damages? What is the damage issue conversation like with you and your legal team?
It's complicated. It's amazing you went directly to that. I can tell the brilliance of Eboni K. Williams by that question. And the reason I say that is because you get to the root of the question of how much is a Black life worth? And you begin to, if you start there, you realize that during life, these children weren't given the benefit of their humanity, and they were children when they were brutally bombed. And so you realize that, and then you say, well, we're not suing about their life, but we're suing about what happened to them in their death. And we also saw that they were prostituted, that they were literally, their remains were perverted. The University of Pennsylvania literally would give their remains to students to take home to study. These are the remains of your loved ones you thought were being buried. They were taking them out and utilizing them on fundraising escapades. I mean, the things that the University of Pennsylvania did to these beautiful Black girls and their bones and their remains is just one of the most disgusting, perverse things. It's the larger question of why is the Black body treated as such? And why would someone take Black bones and hold them the way that they did in Black skulls? And so we do have a case right now pending against the University of Pennsylvania and the city of Philadelphia.
Can you tell us a little bit about, Lionell, the conversations your family is having around this issue? Obviously, I can't help but think the holidays are coming up. Does this weigh heavily on y'all? And is it something that y'all talk about as a family?
I mean, me and my children, yes, I tell them, don't let this be something that goes swept under the rug. I'm going to seek justice to the fullest extent, because if this happened to me, I know my sister would have done the same thing, if not more. And I can never do enough to keep their memory alive, given the fact they died in this horrible fire, and to be forgotten about 37 years later, I had to come forward and rightfully collect what's left of my sister's remains.
Can you tell us a little bit about them? What were they like? What were their personalities like? What do you most remember about them?
Well, see, that's where the gray area, because I was so young when they died. They died in 85. I was only 8 years old. And the first confrontation happened in 78. And I was only 2 years old. My grandma took me away from that situation. I raised my aunts, and then my grandma passed away. And then, you know, 37 years later, I'm saying, wow, I can do something with my sister. I'm grown now. I can step in and get them out of harm's way, which is the institution that had them and the medical examiner's office. I can take them away from Philadelphia, the city that helped kill them, and give them a final resting place for someone to actually love them, which is me.
Where are you, and where would you ideally like for your sister's remains to have that peaceful, you know, rightful resting place?
Once I get me a house, I plan to probably bury them on my land, and not when I pass away, have my wife or someone scatter them in my coffin, take them with me, but they will never be left behind ever again.
Mr. Dotson, we just want to thank you so much for sharing such a personal, important story. So many of us have never heard of what happened to your family and your sisters. Thank you both for joining us. Up next, a disturbing case that's got a lot of people wanting answers. Much more on the death of Shaquilla Robinson after the break.